Hello. Today, it's mostly going to be about very feng shui specific work and fairly advanced stuff, but that might be the best way to approach the topic at hand, which is customizing the combat tracker. Combat is one of the areas where Foundry makes more assumptions than usual. It presumes that characters have to make some kind of initiative roll, the result of which determines a turn order that stays the same for the duration of the encounter. Customizing the roll formula for initiative might be enough for a lot of games, but not for Feng Shui, who does things quite differently. In the interest of time, I'll explain as I go. There are primarily two classes that interest us for running custom combat. The first one is combat, which is the entity that represents an encounter. That's where most of the work is going to happen. Once you've created your own class extending combat, you'll want to go to the main JavaScript file and set config.combat.entityClass to your newly created class in the init hook. The other class we care about is Combat Tracker. This is the sidebar tab where all the combat control happens. Depending on your system, you might be able to get away with leaving that one untouched, but we'll need to add some controls for the characters, so we have to extend it. To tell Foundry to use your combat tracker, you'll need to override the config.ui.combat property in the init hook. Now, let's go back to our custom combat class and start customizing. Let's start simple and override the sortCombatant function. A combatant is an object that represents a token taking part in this combat, along with all the associated data such as initiative. By default, combatants are sorted in decreasing order of initiative, breaking ties with alphanumerical sorting. In Feng Shui, we also sort in the same order, but the tiebreaker is different, in that player characters have priority. So we're going to grab the type of each combatant, and if they're mismatched and one of them is a player character, then that character gets priority. Otherwise, the order doesn't matter much, so we're just sorting them by token ID. Foundry will use this function to sort an array called turns, which holds the turn order. Next, we'll override prepareCombatant, which sets up the combatant object. We'll call the parent function first, and then we'll add our own source. In Feng Shui, characters essentially have to spend points in order to take action. This is called the shot cost of an action. For each combatant, we want to know how many shots they have spent at the end of their turn. For that, we'll use the combatant's flags property, which we can use to store arbitrary data. You have to use this, otherwise the data won't persist across sessions. In this case, we'll either use the existing value or set it to the default, which is set to 3 in the config file. We have to do it this way because prepareCombatant is called fairly often, and not just once at the creation of the encounter. Where Feng Shui deviates from Foundry's assumptions is that the turn order is not fixed. Spending shot effectively reduces your initiative, and the next character to act is the one who has the most shots left, which could be the same character. And you keep going until no one has shots left to spend, at which point it is the end of the round, or sequence as it's called in this system. For readability, I still want the combatants to be sorted by initiative, which means we'll constantly sort the turn order after each action. This also means that the active character is always going to be the first one in the list. To ensure this, we will override the rollInitiative function so that after it's done its thing, we're updating the combat entity to first the turn property to 0. As you may have guessed, this property tells us which combatant's turn it is. It is an index to the turns array. The next function we'll override is startCombat, which is what happens when you click on the Begin Combat button in the combat tracker. By default, it doesn't do much, just setting the round and turn counters, which we'll still want to happen, so we'll call the parent function. But before that, we'll call the pre-existing setUpTurns function, just to make doubly sure that the combatants are sorted properly. Now, this is where things get exotic. As you probably know, in the combat tracker, you can not only advance in the turn order, but you can also go back. That's easy when all you need to do is go back one step in the turns array, but that's not going to cut it with our constantly changing turn order. So, in order to support going back in time, we'll have to maintain our own undo stack, which I'll refer to as the combat history. For that, we'll use flags again, though they are set a bit differently for combat instances, using the setFlag function. If you've watched the video about game settings, the syntax is similar, where you need to define a scope, a name, and a value. The turn order is going to be a stack of all the turn order changes and will be initialized with an empty array in start combat. Before moving on to redefining turn order progression, I want to create a few convenience functions. The first ones are going to give us an easy way to push and pop the turn history. The important thing to remember here is making a copy of the object, which I'm doing using the slice function, and setting the flag to point to that copy. If you just modify the original object, the changes won't persist when you close or refresh Foundry, because the database system doesn't see that as a change or something. This is an area I don't know much about. The next convenience function is for spending shots. This will take a combatant and a number of shots as arguments. Before we do anything else, we need to store the current state of the combatant, so we'll push a new object at the top of the turn history stack, taking note of the combatant's ID, its initiative before spending the shots, and the number of shots it's going to spend. After that, we'll calculate the new initiative value and update the combatant accordingly. We'll also reset the shot cost to its default value while we're here. Note that the combat class has a setInitiative function, but I'm not using it because it's ensuring the active combatant doesn't change, and I don't want that. With those functions, managing turn order will be a lot simpler. Let's start with the nextTurn function. We'll grab the active combatant using this.combatant. If that combatant's initiative is 0 or negative, it means there's nothing left to do in this round, so we trigger the next round of combat. Otherwise, we get the number of shots the combatant is going to spend, and spend them. I know I haven't explained where those shots come from. I'll get to that in a bit. It's better to finish writing this class first. We'll finish this function by updating the combat. This might not be necessary, but I want to make sure the active combatant is always the first one, at least for now. After next turn, let's look at next round. Similar to next turn, we're going to start by saving information we'll need to undo this action. In this case, this means saving the state of every combatant at once in a separate array. We're also going to push a string called newRound as a marker of the start of a new round. Next, we need to handle initiative penalties. In Feng Shui, you are allowed to spend more shots than you have, but if you do, you'll get an initiative penalty in the next round. We will store that in the combatant's flags. Speaking of initiative, in Feng Shui, you reroll initiative in every round, so we'll need to reset initiative by calling the resetAll function, which will re-enable the initiative buttons for all the combatants. Finally, we update the combat entity by incrementing the round number. Another thing you might want to do when updating a combat entity after a turn or a round is advance time. It is possible to keep track of passing game time by setting the advance time property in the second argument of the update function. To do so, you'll want to define the config.time.runtime, or turn time as the case may be, in the init hook. If you're not overriding the combat control function, that's all you need to do. Otherwise, you'll have to copy the time advancing code from the parent function or do your own calculations. Feng Shui doesn't really care about time passing, but it does say how long a sequence is supposed to last, so I might as well implement it. Before looking at the undo functions, let's talk about how I'm handling this initiative penalty. You see, the initiative formula as I defined it in the system.json file says nothing about initiative penalty. And since I like to avoid adding terms to a formula if they are irrelevant, this means I need to alter the initiative formula at some point. Fortunately, this is possible by overriding the getInitiativeFormula function. We'll call the parent function to retrieve the formula, and if the combatant has initiative penalty, we'll append that to the formula. Pretty simple. Before we try this all out, let's finish off this class with the two remaining functions we need to override. Let's start with previous round. If there is a turn to go back to, remember that rounds are one indexed here, we'll grab the turn history. I'm not using the convenience function here because there are a few operations we're going to take on the history. First, we pop the top of the stack and check what it is. If it's an array, this means we're holding the array describing the state of the combat at the end of the round, which is what we want. If not, this means the user clicked on the previous round button somewhere in the middle of a round. In this case, we're going to look for the last instance of the new round marker, use the splice function to remove that marker and everything after that. This will leave us with the round end state array as the last element, which we're going to retrieve with a pop. We save the updated turn history, then pass that end state array to restore all combatants to the way they were when the last round ended. Then we finish by updating the combat round value. Finally, there is the previous turn function, where we'll do something similar, starting with popping the top of the stack. If the turn history is empty, or if we reached a new round marker, it means we were at the beginning of the round, so we should go to the previous round instead. Otherwise, we'll use the data to restore the corresponding combatant to its previous state. Okay, finally we're ready to do some testing. I'm going to grab a bunch of tokens and add them to an encounter, roll initiative, and now you can see that as I click through the various combat control buttons, the turn order and initiative is changing accordingly. We can also see that the history persists if I refresh Foundry, which is important if you need to leave a session halfway through a combat. We can also see how the initiative roll is affected for characters who have overspent shots. The keen-eyed among you might have noticed that if I click next turn when nobody has rolled initiative, it will just go to the next round, which is not ideal. To prevent that, at the top of the next turn function, I'll grab all combatants that have no initiative set, and if there's any, I'll send an error message and exit the function without updating anything. We could stop here, but in this game, an action can cost more than 3 shots, and it's also possible to spend shots when it's not your turn. So, we need to be able to customize how many shots are going to be spent. I'll show a couple of ways of doing this, both of which involve the Combat Tracker class we created at the beginning of this video. First of all, we're going to override the HBS template for the Combat Tracker. For this template, we're going to find the original Combat Tracker template, which lives wherever you install Foundry, in apps, templates, sidebar, combattracker.html. We are then going to copy the whole contents of the file in our custom template. Now, let's find the element called Combat Tracker, which is an ordered list, in which each element represents a combatant. Inside the combatant element, I'm going to add a couple of things. I'll add a text field input I'll call shot cost and give it the value that we stored in the combatant's flags. After that, I'll add a button that I'll call interrupt. This will be used to spend shots out of turn. Note that I'm doing this inside the if statement that checks if the current user is a GM, which means only GMs will be able to see the fields we've just added. To hook these up, we'll be in familiar territory as the Combat Tracker is an application and therefore works a lot like actor sheets we've spent so much time on. We'll add one listener for each of the controls we've added. On the text field, we'll listen to changes and update the combatant's shot cost flag with the value of the field before triggering a refresh of the tracker by calling its render function. On a click of the interrupt button, we simply grab the combatant and spend the shots. And that's about it, really. Pretty simple. I'll be doing the styling off camera because it's nothing we haven't covered before. Note that since we're using the spend shots function, the interrupts will be added to the turn history and therefore will be undoable with the previous turn button. Another way we can make changes to a combatant is through the combatant config form. This is new in Foundry 0.7, so you might not be aware of it, but if you right-click on a combatant and click Update Combatant, you can change a bunch of things about the combatant, such as their status or initiative. It is possible to customize this window, so let's do that. First, we need to extend the combatant config class and point it to a different template. We'll create it in a bit. Let's finish the code first. Going back to the Combat Tracker class, we're going to override onConfigureCombatant, essentially making a copy of the parent function, but instantiating our own version of the combatant config class. Hopefully, in a future version of Foundry, we'll be able to change the class the same way we do others, so we won't need to override this. Finally, just like we did with the combat tracker, we're going to make a copy of the combatant config form, which you can find in the templates/sheets folder of the Foundry app. Then we're simply going to add another form group pointing to the shot cost flag. This works the same way as input fields in the character sheets, so if we name the input element appropriately, the update will be done automatically. Let's give that a try. And yeah, works as expected. Before we go, let me give you one last nugget of knowledge. I've mentioned a few times that this system has a different name for combat rounds, sequences, and you can see that the change has been made, even though I didn't modify this part of the template. In the language pack, I can create a combat section and add a round entry, giving it the value sequence. This will override Foundry string. Use this trick with caution, however, as it has the potential to cause some confusion or clash with other modules. And that's it for today. Thanks for the topic suggestions in the last video. Some of those I definitely need to cover, but I've also got a few ideas on my own. See you next time. Bye.